is Doug Hines with Storage DNA. I wanted to take a little bit of time and say thanks for joining me today for this demo. And we'll take you through all the basics of DNA evolution, which is our LTO archive nearline solution. So the first thing that you'll notice is that our UI is completely browser-based. So you can bookmark the location for the server of our controller and basically click on that, and it'll bring you straight to the login screen. And if you have the ability to save passwords and logins and all that stuff, you can certainly do that. I'm just going to go ahead and grab that from my keychain as well and log right in. As you can see, I'm using Safari and I'm on my Mac. But you can run from any workstation, any platform that you'd like. And this is the UI of DNAevolution. It's the latest and greatest version. And it essentially has evolved over time and has a lot of great features in it. First off, right as I logged in as an admin, so you can actually see all features and functions of the system. When you log in as an other type of user, a different profile, some of these actual functions will go away. So for instance, as a non-admin user, when I log in, the reports menu goes away, system settings, users and group administration go away. So these completely just disappear. And for a normal user that, you know, basically is going to be using the system day in and day out, they'll have the main, you know, buttons that they need to and features and functions. But we have three different user profiles, just so you're aware, so that when you log in and as an admin, I can actually create three different user types. I've got an admin, another admin I can create, or I can make a normal user or a limited user. And the way this works is that by user profile or user role, you will have functionality changes. Okay, so that basically allows you to limit what a particular user can do within the system. And then what we have is groups of users who can be assigned to different buckets of content, essentially, or what we call an archive within the system. So once you set up your users, you can then assign them to a group, and you can create as many groups as you want. You can put a description in here, and that way, when you create a group, it can have an admin user, a normal user, and a limited user in it. And when they log in, they'll have access to a specific set of content, but they won't necessarily be able to, you know, administrate it or, you know, do certain features or functions within that archive. So that's kind of the way users and groups is divvied up. And that's one of the first things that a lot of people will either, you know, think about when they get the system and start, you know, figuring out how they want to slice and dice their user base or not. There's many customers in our install base who don't use that at all. Every time I log in, they just go in as admin and everybody else on the network goes in as admin. But the key here is that you can use it or you don't have to. The system's very flexible that way. So that's the first thing that a lot of people will think about. I'm going to kind of go at this sort of non-linearly in terms of the way that people will approach using the system. So that would be the first place. The second place that people will, you know, venture into is in the clients tab up here, and they're going to go over to the tape devices area, because this is the first thing that you'll have to do as a user is you'll have to format your tapes, because they don't come formatted with LTFS format on them out of the package or out of the wrapper. So this is the first place that you'll come in. Formatting is done here. This button right here is the format button. One thing to remember with our UI is that you have to actually highlight the item on the left-hand side of the appropriate selection first, otherwise you will not get the desired results on the right hand side of the UI. So for instance, if I was to come to this and click on the DNA server and I'm on my tape devices tab now, I don't see any drives here, right? But if I click on the proper item on the left hand side, now I have my information that I'm expecting, which is my tape drive, single drive. So when you go into format, which is very straightforward, you basically are going to just going to have a pop-up window that's going to allow you to, if you're in a single drive environment, you're going to allow you to enter a tape serial information because single drives don't have barcode readers. And that has to match the barcode label that's on the tape. And just so you know, we do highly recommend that you have barcode labels regardless of whether you're using a single drive or not, because you never know when that tape might be introduced into a library environment. And if it doesn't have a barcode label on it, you're going to be in trouble because it's not going to be readable, not going to be recognizable by that library. So the key there is to make sure that you always have barcode labels. They get professionally made, they get affixed to the tapes, and then you make sure that you input the tape serial here manually, or if you actually did have an autoloader, that tape serial, whatever was might be loaded into that particular drive, would actually pre-fill for you, and then you can go ahead and just format. Reformatting is also an option as well. So if you make a mistake and you want to reformat a tape, you just choose the force format button here as a checkbox. I'm not going to do that or even do a format right now because I don't have any tapes right now, but we don't need that for the demo, but I just wanted to show you where this functionality is and where it resides. We also have some generic, you know, mount, unmount. If you have an autoloader, you can actually see the autoloader through another window here. If I click on it right now, I'm just going to have a window that says, hey, I only have a single drive. I don't have an autoloader. But with an autoloader view, you'd see all the slots, any tapes that might be in all the slots, and this applies to any autoloader. Doesn't matter whether it's something you buy from Storage DNA or whether it's a third party that you have integrated with, etc. We have a secondary verification function as well. We have duplication as well too. So these are post-job types of functions. So verification is a secondary one. We actually do real-time MD5 checksum verification as we're writing to the original files to the tape. And so if a job completes without any errors or issues, then you know that stuff has been MD5 checksummed. But what we want you to be able to do is later on, let's say, you know, you write to the tape over the course of a month and you finally fill up that single tape, which is perfectly valid situation now that LTO7 can hold up to 6 terabytes. You want to be able to re-verify all the files on that given tape. And so that's what this secondary verification choice is here. Also, in terms of duplication, duplication is done after the fact. We do not write from the same job to two separate tapes at the same time. You can certainly have multiple jobs running at the same time with DNAevolution from different archives and using different content and sources, etc. But we do not write simultaneously to two tapes at the same time. So the duplication function makes an exact clone for you of that particular original tape, and that of course will also require that you have two tape drives. So duplication only applies if you have two tape drives. If I choose to duplicate here, and if I decide I want to, you know, just try to put in a number here, it's going to say okay. Hey, hold on here. Tape duplication requires two LTO tape devices connected to a single archive manager. Okay, so the duplication function only works in a two drive minimum situation. So that's how that stuff works. So these are the two first areas that most people will start getting involved in directly. Is the users and groups set up if they want to do that, and then, you know, formatting tapes, you know, once again. Once you format your tapes, they become available in this list. So we have a My Tapes tab here that essentially provides a list of all tapes, and this will show you all tapes that have ever been processed through DNAevolution. Now, this means that these tapes could potentially be offline. And as a matter of fact, all of the tapes in on the screen right now and in my system are offline. And I know that very quickly and easily because of the font that we are displaying here. So if you click on any one of these, you'll see once again, information on the right side changes. So that's once again, the way our UI works. That's the model that you should get used to. So if you click on DNA001, which is in italicized black font, the name of it. I know right away that this is an offline tape. This tape is not available at this time, but I can still see all the information about it. I can see the last known capacity. I can see that either in both a sort of a gas gauge view over here with a little green progress bar, so to speak, in right next to the tape icon, or I can come over here and look at the actual capacity and bits and bytes. So that's always available, regardless of whether the tape's online or offline. So this is a key thing to remember, is that we are tracking content regardless of whether tapes are online or not. And when you decide and you find some content that you want to do a restore of, we'll tell you that that tape is offline and that you have to go get it and stick it into the system in order to do a restore. But I'll show you that as we go. As you can imagine, in a lot of cases, over time, this list of tapes will become very, very long. So we have some filtering here. You can go through and say, hey, show me all my full tapes, show me all my empty tapes, any unassigned tapes, etc. So you can do that, or you can go in and you can type in an archive name if you want to, or you can filter by, you know, specific. And if, let's say you want to find DNA001, which is the first one in my list, and say search, there it is. So if the list starts, you know, basically overwhelming your screen size and it becomes very big and long, you can definitely find your content, or your tapes, excuse me, by the filtering that we have. So as you notice, we can, you know, click on one of these items here, and you notice that there's a bunch of fields of information on the right-hand side that you can actually fill in as an end user. Any user on the system can do this. So if DNA001, which is a typical, potentially is a barcode label naming convention, which is six characters and they have to be alphanumeric, that may not mean much to end users. So what you can do is you can come in and you can say, hey, this is for project, you know, ABC, I don't know. And you can put a location here, because once again, I know that it's not in the system. So I can say it's at a client site, and then I can put some notes in here. Maybe I'll change these notes to make a little more sense, you know, for demo. Okay, and then we also pre-fill all the different archives that content has been written to this particular tape from, and we'll talk about archives in a second, but we do, as you can see, I tend to kind of use a couple of tapes and do all my demos and assign them to many, many different archives. But that's something we'll talk about as well, as in terms of tape assignment is another thing to think about and how you want to work with that. We also will pre-fill if verification has been done and when it was done. Okay, so that's the My Tapes area. You will have access to that from, you know, anybody's UI will have access to that. That's a standard function or feature that will always be available to any user, whether you're, you know, essentially a standard user or admin, etc. So the other thing is that once the tapes are formatted, you've done a little note-taking if you need to on those as well, they now are available to use for your archives. And so now if I click on my archives here, you'll see that I've got a big long list of different and folders. What they look like is folders, and these are our organizational structure within our catalog system. And this is the first place that you're going to basically use to organize your content. So archives are essentially catalog entries within our database structure, and that's how you start organizing your material. So as you can see, I've got a whole bunch here, just, you know, various different demos that I do or have done in the past. And then also I have this other sort of construct here, which is a folder drop-down or tip-down, which allows me to group archives together. Okay, so I can do this either beforehand or after. So for instance, I created a September 2016 folder here that, you know, I gathered up all my IBC projects that I had worked on. So that's the kind of thing that you can use to organize your material in any way that you would like. So this is completely customizable, very straightforward. You can name these anything you'd like. It can be by client, by project, by day of the week, by month, by year, however you want to slice and dice your content. And if many people may already have an existing structure or scheme that they have, and we can fit right into that because you can just take on the same naming convention if you'd like, or you can start from scratch and begin your entire archive structure in a new fashion if you'd like to. It's completely flexible. Very simple to create a brand new archive. The first thing you're going to do is just click on this plus button over here. It says create new archive. And you get a dialog box here, and this will be something that people will get used to very quickly, is that you have to assign a name, right? And basically we'll just put in, for demo video, because I don't know if I might have already another one that's named that. And then we'll just put in some text and just say, kicking off the new year, and then I'm going to assign one or more than one tape to the archive. Now, something to be said about what this process is all about is that assigning tapes to an archive is completely up to the end users, and there are no restrictions in terms of assigning tapes to archives. Meaning that if a tape has already been assigned to a previous archive, there is nothing in the system that allows, doesn't allow, or restricts an end user from assigning it to another. So if you do have some restrictions that you want to put in place, you have to sort of set those rules up outside of DNAevolution and make sure you have a, a cheat sheet somewhere that says, hey, tapes 1 through 5 are for project X, and 5 through 10 or 6 through 10 are through project Y, and they should never cross, because that's something that our software basically allows you to do, is have essentially multiple projects or archives all being written to different tapes, and there's not a restriction in the system to basically limit that. So one thing to be aware of. So I'm going to go ahead and create this new archive. And it says, hey, you have created this successfully. So now I have this archive. It says for demo video. And if you take a look on the left-hand side, you'll notice that that is the item that is highlighted. If I don't highlight anything, or if I click from one to the other, you'll see the title change here, right? And the key here is that, once again, the same mechanism for kind of seeing anything within the UI is dependent on what you have selected on the left hand side. Okay, very straightforward. But this is an empty archive now. There's nothing here. It says no items found in this folder. So it's basically a brand new archive, right? So if I want to get started and I want to bring some material in, I'm going to go over to this big button, the archive button. So now over on the left hand side, we have archives as what I would call nouns. They're basically things within the catalog. But now if I go over to this button and I choose the archive button, this is sort of like a verb version of archive, meaning I want to write something to tape, right? And because I've already selected which tapes have been assigned to this archive, because I did that, remember how I chose those when I first established the archive? Then I'm all set to go. So once I go into the archive console, and it's going to basically ask me a couple of questions up front with a brand new archive. And those questions are going to be centered around what machines I have involved in this job, essentially. So there's a source machine selection, and then there's also a target machine selection. These can be one and the same, okay? And if you're in a smaller configuration that doesn't require that you have multiple workstations with separate content coming from different storages, and they all have access to the same storage that you need to archive from, then this is a perfectly valid environment. If it is a scenario where you might have another workstation that has specific content that only it has access to, then you might have that listed in your source machine list here. The target machine one is the one that's connected to the LTO hardware. Okay, so you could potentially have multiples of each of these in your environment, and that's how configurations grow and sort of expand horizontally across an environment, essentially, is that you can have multiple source machines that have, sort of exclusive access to different storages that you might want to archive from. Maybe it's internal storage or some local storage that's connected to a workstation that you want to archive. You can certainly set up our system to be very wide-ranging and have access to it. Target machines can be multiple as well, so meaning we can actually control multiple libraries. So you can have a library for your graphics team, or you can have a library for your editorial team specifically designated for them, and those would be the items that you would select when you set up the job. But I'm just going to go ahead and create here, and I'll just authenticate against my local workstation in order to create that job. That's always going to happen. And this is a one-time situation. That job is now set up and ready to go. And as you can see, our archive console is very straightforward. We've got four sections: the archive summary area, which shows you kind of all the statuses of everything that's going on. You've got, your buttons that, hit go and stop and all that good stuff on the lower left. And then on the upper right, this is where you do most of your work, right? You're going to add folders, you're going to add sources and things like that in this environment. So, and then down on the lower right, you've got a history or a status, and multiple, readouts of all the different jobs and, what happened with each one, et cetera, over time. To get started archiving, the first thing most people will do is they'll start out using folder-based archiving. And so the UI starts out and is set up to start working that way right away. So you have an Add Folder button right here in the upper right-hand corner, which is the Archive Folder selection area. And this is where you would actually go in and so make your selection for items to be archived. And this is where you navigate to your volumes, whether it's local volumes, could be SAN volumes, NAS volumes, whatever's mountable on the desktop of that workstation that you selected at the very beginning of the setup for this job as the source machine. Okay, so source machine, whatever volumes are available to that will be available to select and pick whatever folder of worth of material. So let's say I want my Avid Media Files folder. I say, okay, there we are. We're ready to go, right? So now there's a couple different things you can do. You can actually hit the Start Job button right now and kick that job off, or you could actually set up some automation if you wanted to. And so if you got a autoloader environment where you might want to run jobs, later in the evening, after hours, that kind of thing, you can certainly set up a schedule very simply and easily with our UI here. So you've got, manual is the default, but you can certainly pick, either a weekly type of job run. You can maybe even do a daily job run of the same material. Or you could choose a sub 24-hour time frame. So essentially making that selection that you picked a watch folder. So anytime any additional new material gets added to it, we'll look at, if you choose 10 minutes, we'll look at that folder every 10 minutes and basically take a look at it and see if there's been any new material added to it. If there's not, we won't run the job. So that's the key thing to remember about our automated jobs is that they automatically will kick into incremental mode for you by default. So any job that gets basically run repeatedly or consecutively and has the same source and same target and is the same archive, it'll basically just incrementally take a look at what's already been written to tape and only look for any new files or any change files. And so that's how you can actually build a daily backup if you want to of your content. Very simply. So the other thing that you can do in addition to scheduling jobs is you can set filter types, right? So you can say, hey, I only want certain file types to be archived, or maybe I want to exclude some file types, right? So you have all these choices to be able to include all files include only the following types or include all files except the following. So we actually have our own hit list of files, file system files that we don't like. It's not necessarily that we care whether they get written to tape or not, but if you were to do a restore and reintroduce some of these files into a live file system environment, you could have some trouble. So, you know, things like Spotlight V100s on a Mac or the recycle folder on a PC, that kind of stuff, you just don't want to, you know, be bothered with archiving it. So we actually have this on our default list of files not to archive, but you can certainly turn that off and include all files, right? You can turn that off. And we've also got a couple other pre-built filter types. You know, we've got AVID file types, so you can see, you know, this basically takes into account every single kind of AVID file type. You know, system files, office docs. I don't know why people would do that, but you can pick it if you want to. And if that's not enough, you can also set your own policies. So you can say, hey, you know, I only want file names that, you know, end with, you know, .mxf, right? So we can go ahead and add that in. Now we can also add more stuff. So we can say, hey, maybe I want a modified time of more than, you know, 7 days old here, right? And then I also want to add another, maybe a size delimiter. Maybe I want it to be at least 500 megabytes in size, right? So I can go ahead and do that too. And then I can set that policy, and I can say I want all files that transfer, they have to match all the criteria or any one of the three criteria or more items that I put in that list. So it's a pretty easy, straightforward UI to do something more than just copying every single item within a given folder over to tape, right? So you can really get selective and pick and choose what you want to do by a variety of different criteria. So that's a real basic view of folder-based archiving. So that's the first way most people kind of look at the system and start working with the system just to kind of get their feet wet. There is another alternative method that allows you to do some more sophisticated stuff. And that's ticket-based archiving. And so I'm going to switch right over to that as opposed to doing folder-based within this exact same archive. And it's set up a different kind of a job here. Now I'm going to add a ticket. Instead of adding a folder, I have this choice to add a ticket. And when I want to add a ticket, I can go in and I can pick a different kind of configuration here. And this is basically our ability to interpret metadata representations of content, meaning an AAF file exported, a project file directly, maybe a project file from AVID or from Premiere Pro, maybe a Final Cut Pro XML. And we also have our plugins for Interplay and CatDV in here as well. So this is where you can actually get very granular with your actual, you know, what you want to have moved. And so you can do project-based here. You can do bins or sequences worth of material, very specific, by just simply exporting that file out of your nonlinear editing system and placing it in a location that you know where to find it. And then you can basically go off. And so you got to pick your configuration first. And I'll just do a real quick one, just a quick example of an AVID file. Project. So I'll just go in instead of volumes. I'm going to pick my location where my AVID project files are. So I'm going to go in to my AVID projects folder, and I'll just randomly pick AVID project 1, very simply, right? And so now I have that as my location and where we're going to look for what we call a ticket, and I'm going to go ahead and add that ticket, right? Now you see that what we've done is we've interpreted the project folder as it existed on my internal drive in my projects folder, and we were able to call out each individual bin separately right here, and then we also gather up a separate line item that's called other project files. And if I view the file listing for that item, I'm going to see all my files that were in my project folder. So I'm going to basically go grab and essentially copy everything to tape, so that you now have, in total, a physical copy of the files themselves, the project files and bin files themselves. And then what's going to happen is I'm going to have a separate listing that is basically going to provide me with individual listings for each bin. And you'll see that we've given you a warning on a couple of these. And this warning is great because this is actually sort of the beauty of this function, right? Is it gives you the ability to see if you've got any files missing or not before you commit to running this job. And so it knows what files are associated with every bin and the entire project in general, and it's going to call those out. And if there's any missing, I can go ahead and take a look at the file listing for this line item, and you can see that, you know, there's four files that are missing. They have the warnings on them, and now these are three, you know, four .movie files. And now if I take a look, I can see that, hey, they're coming off of a different, completely different volume, directory, etc. It could be a different drive, right? So it is actually a different drive that they're coming off of. So this could be as simple as just going and mounting that volume. Maybe it's just not mounted on the desktop of the Mac that I'm running from. Very simple though to be able to identify that and see where these files might be coming from, or where the project says they're coming from, right? And so this is great because in a volume or folder only based type of workflow, you're not going to get this kind of heads up. You're going to just assume essentially that you know, everything that you're intending to archive is there and present and accounted for, but there's no check and balance. And this is a great, you know, feature. It gives you that capability. So you can see this other one has a couple of files missing as well. Same kind of thing. You know, they're coming from that same set of files, and then maybe even a different, you know, different volume altogether, right? So this is a great new feature, and this is just an addition to what we were always able to do, which is work with AAF files and XML files and things like that. So we can do this both for Adobe projects and Avid projects, as you can see. So this is one of the great new features of DNAevolution. Back into an archive that actually has some material that's been written to tape. And now I'm going to take you through how you can actually interact with that content. We give you actually three different distinctly, you know, separate views of the same content. So we're in an archive called SFTV Season 1, which is Sport Fishing Television Season 1, which is a bunch of content that I got, actual real content, and a project that I got from a friend of mine who actually works at Bonnier Corporation and does the editing there, or oversees the editing there. So this content exists on a few tapes, and we'll take you through and let you see how you actually work with the content within the system once it's been archived, right? So the idea is this could be, you know, 2 weeks later, 3 months later, 6 months later, a year later, 5 years later. And you're coming in and you say, hey, I got to go to Sport Fishing Television Season 1, and I need to find some stuff. So if you have a good memory, and if it wasn't too long ago, and you know the directory structure, you could actually just navigate, you know, through and say, you know what, I'm looking for some content, and I know it was in, you know, episode 12, file K. And I can go ahead and just proceed, and I can just say, hey, you know what, I'm looking for the run sheet and script. So if I just double click one more time, there those files are. So I could either pick those individually, or I could just go up one level and pick the folder. And I can just say, restore it. So I've basically navigated through, and if I knew where my content was and how I've structured the material on disk, we're going to have the exact same directory structure listed in our UI as well. So you can actually, you know, confirm via breadcrumb exactly the path that this material came from. And you can say, yep, that's what I'm looking for. I'm ready to go. So now you can click on the restore button with this highlighted. And then now you get a dialogue that just says, hey, what do you want to send this material? Do you want it to go back to all of its original locations? So if your sources and your volumes are all named the same, you can send it back. Sometimes that's required, sometimes not. We default to being custom, which means you have to basically tell us, go out and navigate to a new location. So I can come out here and say, you know what, I want to drop it into, you know, this 10 GB folder and say, okay. All right, so you can pick either one. It's completely up to you. But when you do that, after you're done, you hit the restore ticket, And then what we'll do is automatically drop you into our restore console, which looks very similar to our archive console, but it's got this yellow or orangish border around the edge as opposed to the blue. And then you'll see that request processed, right? So here's the date, 1/9/2017 at 1:11 in the afternoon. That's when I basically processed this ticket. And you'll see those three files listed. It'll show you that, you know, there's a total of 8 megabytes in size, which is tiny, obviously, because there's just a couple Word docs and a project XML. But that could be very valuable if it's a big chunk of stuff, content that you're trying to restore, and you need to know how much that is so that you can carve that space out on your hard drive somewhere, right, to do that restore. So that's a valuable piece of information. And then you'll notice that the tape name over here, and it's LTO601 is the tape name that this three files are coming from, it's in this big bold red font. Well, that indicates to me, as an end user, that that tape is offline. It's not in the hardware anywhere. It's not identified in an autoloader. It's not in the current drive. It's not anywhere that we can find. So you actually have to go and fetch this. So it could be out on a shelf somewhere. And that's why back when I showed you where you can actually add information about a location for a tape, maybe it's at the client, maybe it's at the DR facility, maybe it's wherever, but you have to go get it and insert it into the system in order for you to be able to do this restore, okay? And then once you do that, it'll come green, and you're ready to go. You can go ahead and hit start job on that restore, okay? So that's the first way people work with their content, is at the folder level, you know, which is fine. Everybody kind of gets that, and a lot of people are very organized on disk, so it translates very nicely over into our archive because we give you the same view, right? But there's other ways to look at your material, exact same material. The most unique one is this way, which is looking at the material at the clip level. Okay, so material at the clip level means that when we archive material, we're extracting metadata all the way to that point where we identify clip names. So we show you this as clip names, not file names anymore. It's clip name. And so now I can do searches right within this window, and I can say, you know, this is fishing footage. You know, maybe there's some shark shots out there. Right. And of course, this is all dependent on whether your editors and anybody involved in the production process is making changes within the editorial tool to make these changes and obviously mark these up and give them names. Right. So this was a fairly extensive, you know, work that somebody's done and really labeled these clips really well. But now I'm able to find those based on just a keyword, right? So you can do that. You can find clips, and now I have 14 clips, and you may notice that they're, you can see that they're all dot movie style clips. They're self-contained, but you also see that there's a couple items next to it, to the left of the actual clip icon, and one of them is a tag. It looks like a little tag. That means there's additional metadata added to this material, and then there's also an eyeball next to some of them. I'll take a just click on the first one, and we're going to bring up our clip information window. And this is part of our, what we would call our mini MAM functionality, or, you know, some people refer to it as that, but it just gives you the ability to have a preview directly within our UI, right? So this UI has a built-in HTML5 player that you can link your low-res files to, right? So we have a location that we can be pointed to, and we can actually be pointed to any location. You just tell us where that is. And we will do a match of all the files. We'll index that location. We'll take a look at the file names and the directory structure, and we'll be able to match those up against what's in our catalog, right? Remember how we keep track of the directory structures and names and all that good stuff? We can do a match. So if we get a match, you'll see, be able to see a preview of it. And one note about the proxies or the previews, we don't create those. So that is not a function that DNA Evolution can do. It does not create proxies or previews. That's something you'll have to set up with a third-party transcoding solution. We were used to use and recommend Episode Pro, but at this point they're kind of out No longer going to be offering that product after I think a certain point in the future. So anything like that that can, you know, basically create a low res version of your file, we can be pointed to it. Over on the right hand side, we've got the ability for you to add in, you know, cue point information, which sticks to a point in time within the clip. So as I click on these, you'll see that, you know, the timeline, you're moving along in the timeline. And you can now search against any one of these items. So for instance, let's say I took a note and I wasn't sure what I was looking for, but I don't know the clip names, but I'm looking for the word flyover, right? If I type in flyover, I do a search, and you notice all these clip names, none of them say anything about flyover, but if I click on any one of these, and I drag this over, you can see the word flyover a couple of times in here, right? So I was able to find that based on a cue point that I put in here, and if you take a look at it, it's basically a clip that is, you know, an aerial shot over an island somewhere in the Caribbean. So you can actually key off of and do searches against metadata, both additional metadata, that means stuff that I added, or against any of the native metadata. So for instance, let's say I know this material was shot at a place called Martin's West. Maybe that's one of our episodes. That's where we, a location. So if I type in the word Martin, I hit return, it found 24 clips. If I go into even one without a proxy or a preview, and you'll just get an unsupported video thing here. But if you go to the extracted metadata area, you'll see that you can filter, and you can type in just MAR, and it'll bring you straight to the match. So you can see here that this is from the P2 plugin for Final Cut Pro, of all things. A value of Martin's West was initially entered in the P2 information for this clip. So I was able to find against native metadata. I just showed you some additional metadata that I could add myself to the clip and do searches on and find that material. So once again, you find what you're looking for. I got 24 clips with the word Martin in the metadata, and I can select all these. I didn't mean to click on it, but I can select one, or maybe I just want the ones with these guys here, and I'll just command down there, shift on those, and now I can do the same thing. I just hit the restore button, right? And this is restoring at the clip level. Now, for self-contained clips, no big deal, because it's just a single file. But for certain formats like P2 and XDCAM and things like that, there's a whole bunch of files that go along with a single clip, right? So if I choose P2 stuff, and, you know, let's say I find a clip, maybe it's this guy here, and I want to restore that, what happens when I choose to do the restore, right? So I get the same choices as I do for folder-based. Do I want to restore all the files to the original locations, or do I want to send it somewhere else? So I just choose to send it to the original source, and I'll process this ticket. And what you'll see is you'll end up seeing a ticket that has a date and timestamp drop down to the bottom here that has 9 files associated with it. So we were able to process with that one request, 9 separate files are going to get restored in a total, you know, megabytes, 54 megabytes in size, right? So if I view the file listing, you'll notice that we've got the audio tracks, which are these guys, MXF files, and then the video MXF, and then the sidecar XML, the MP4, a BMP, and a bin file. So we understand clip structures of all the different major formats that you work with day in and day out, including things like this. C300 is another one, where basically there's a very, you know, specific folder structure to the clip, and, you know, Avid knows how to deal with that, and so do we. So the bottom line is that if you want to restore just an individual clip, doesn't matter what format it is, we will restore that for you so that your NLE system knows what to do with it, knows how to work with it, and it's not going to end up just being a bunch of files in just a single folder or just out on your desk somewhere, desktop somewhere. We're going to maintain that original directory structure. So if this stuff came on off of P2, essentially a P2 card, and you archived it direct, and it was in the right structure, that's the way it's going to go back, right? That's the way it's going to get restored so that your NLE system can work with that individual clip and know that those files all belong together. Okay, so that's another great piece of our solution that pretty much nobody else has, is the ability to work at the clip level and understand all the different clip types and allow you to pick and choose, find based on clips, and also do restores based on clips. So that's a key piece there. And then, of course, we give you a third view, which is the file view, which allows you to put a wildcard in. Let's say you want to just see everything. You can do either a star or a forward slash, I think it is. And you show all your files, right? So this is what most other solutions will show you, is just a list of files, which you can do sorting on sizes and types and file names and things like that. But imagine trying to restore just a clip and looking at all my P2 files that may or may not belong together. I don't know exactly. But in this case, most people will restore everything because they don't want to spend the time to hunt and peck and find exactly what they're looking for. So they restore everything. So that's it's a big waste of time and a big waste of resource in terms of capacity and everything else to restore everything when all you need is a single clip's worth of information, right? So that's a key piece of what we do, storage DNA and DNA evolution, in terms of our functionality. Obviously, you can use this to find, if you're in a big archive, this entire, season's worth of material. Maybe you want to find all your graphics, which happen to be PNGs, right? So you just type in PNG here, and there they all are, right? So then you can say, okay, I'm looking for my closed captions. I could have searched on closed caption as well as a name, but I can just pick those two items, right? Or whatever I'd like, right? So that's kind of how people work day in and day out with the system. There is an alternative method of bringing material back as well, and that's called a manual restore. So if I go into the restore window itself, direct, if you may remember the module on the archive side, we have this ability to essentially add a ticket, and we have can add a ticket coming back the other way as well, where we can do project-based restores directly, Adobe project file, we can take an AAF, and we can do all kinds of things like conforming, meaning, I edited in low resolution and I want to bring back the high resolution material. So we can take these items, which are typically AAFs in a lot of cases, but we can now take ALEs, which is another new function within DNAevolution, which gets you a little bit more flexibility and preciseness. ALEs are more accommodating to having multiple different resolutions, all in the same timeline. Maybe you got some, Red and some GoPro and some C300 stuff all in the same timeline. An ALE is going to give you that exact capability to be able to do a restore of the high res material that might have been editing with a lower version of it in Media Composer. So a lot of these EDLs we deal with, and once again Final Cut XMLs, a lot of these are very specific to very specific workflows, and a lot of times we've been able to accommodate customers who have kind of one-offs and things like don't come right out of the box with our solution, and we can help them out and make those work too. So that's the other way to bring material back or restore material. From the very highest level, that is how people use the system. There is another search, global search tool. So if you remember, I did that search for, let's say, shark. I don't know where that material might reside. Maybe I'm not sure what archive those shots are in, or maybe there's multiples of those shots somewhere out there in my archives. This will search across all the archives and highlight for me over on the left-hand side any matching result, any archive that has a matching result. So if I go into, this one and say, I've got some performance testing things, there's two shots of tiger shark, right? If I go over to my sport fishing television, that's will probably have the most. But I've got things sprinkled across all these different archives. Well, that gives you the ability to search across and find and pinpoint all the results, right? And you can do that against the contents or metadata as well. So globally search against metadata. So that is pretty much the tool set that we provide and what most people do day in and day out with the system. So for any more information, please reach out to us. You can certainly put inquiries into your local reseller, or if they don't carry our line, you can certainly get a hold of us directly. You can go to our website, or you can pick up the phone and give us a shout. We're at storagedna.com. Thanks for spending some time with us today, and we'll talk to you soon. Thanks.